So the topics what we are going to cover in this session is all about introduction, about the SharePoint and how to access the SharePoint. What is SharePoint libraries and how to set up the permissions. And talking about OneDrive, bit of news feeds and some of the SharePoint social features. All right. Okay. So this is the one. So if I talk about, so in your setup, everything is all related to the SharePoint online. Nothing is related to the SharePoint on-prem, correct, Archie?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Is it very frequently you guys access the SharePoint site? So it's very, the access is very rare.
Oh. It's pretty frequent.
Possibly,
at least daily, if not weekly.
It is daily, huh?
Yeah, it's at least weekly. It might sometimes daily.
Okay. So, any idea what are your daily activities which you guys perform onto the SharePoint site?
Well, they keep the meetings. They keep the meeting minutes and the slides in SharePoint. And sometimes it's like they put stuff on SharePoint that has to be accessed and where you have to grant approvals and stuff on SharePoint.
Okay. And the permissions and everything are all being set up?
Yeah, somebody else sets the permissions.
Okay, all right.
But I might end up doing that one day. At some point, I may set up the permissions. I don't right now, though.
Well, maybe. Okay. So let's say for a given customer, for a given customer, let's say the environment would be running up on an on-premise, or maybe it's running up on cloud. So it can be any kind of a form, and it can be a mixed environment as well also. So they can sit purely onto the cloud, they can sit purely onto the on-prem, or they can also go with a setup of hybrid. Hybrid in the sense?
Yeah.
The workloads are being distributed from on-prem towards the cloud, depending on in which particular form those services are going to be hosted. Say, for instance, the services are being hosted in a form of infrastructure as a service. Maybe the services are hosted as a platform as a service. Maybe the services are hosted as software as a service. So if you look up the customer and the vendor, so for in our case, the vendor is Microsoft. And we are the customer. So in that case, see, when we are sitting on an on-prem, and when we start moving down towards the cloud, all right, then the responsibilities of the customer changes. Why? Okay. Because there are some shared responsibilities which are being shared and distributed between the customer and the vendor. All right? Okay?
Right.
Just give me a second.
Okay.
So in that case, when we are moving down towards the cloud, the responsibilities of the customer and the responsibilities of the vendor are being shared. So when we move down, let's say this is A. And this is B. Let's say this is C. And let's say this is D. So when we are moving down from A towards D, when we are moving down towards from A towards D,
yeah,
the responsibilities of the vendor are increasing and the responsibilities of the customers are getting reduced.
Okay.
That means if you're sitting on on-prem, the complete responsibility is for the customer.
Right.
Say, for example, if you are owning a vehicle, when you own a vehicle, that means you're the owner of the vehicle. You can drive the vehicle in any form. So, but if in case, if you're moving down towards the SaaS,
mm-hmm.
all right, then in that case, the responsibilities are mostly being taken care of by the vendor. That means, say, for instance, if I'm going with a cab service. Mm-hmm. Now, let's say, for example, Uber. All right?
Yeah.
So when you try to consume, when you try to avail the Uber service, that's a cab service, are you the owner of that Uber vehicle?
No.
No. So you just book the vehicle and you just book the type of the vehicle, you book up the type of the service, and then you use that service and you pay just for the service, right?
Right.
And once you consume the service, you make the payment, and that's it. But on the other hand, if you're owning the vehicle, if you're the owner of the vehicle,
mm-hmm.
then you can imagine that the complete set of a responsibility happens to be the owner.
Right.
Whether it is in terms of maintenance and, let's say, upgrades, anything. Yeah. But those responsibilities here itself, in that case, it's a service provider, which is Uber.
Right.
So we being as a customer itself, we can just go and consume the service and manage the service till some extent, not completely.
Right.
All right. So think about from that aspect. Maybe I'm working in a hybrid model. All right. Sometimes you use your own vehicle, sometimes you use a cab service. All right. Okay.
Yes.
And who is the one who is owning the, who is the one who is the consuming the service? It's none other than the identity. So in a very simple understanding, just consider an example of an identity is a user. All right?
All right.
So the user is the one, or right, let's say identity is the one who can manage the service. Who can manage the service, and the one who can consume the service. All right?
Right.
So when I say manage, manage is meant here itself for delegation. And consume is basically being done by whom? By the end user.
Yes.
What are they trying to consume? They are trying to consume the enterprise applications. And where are these applications? Let's say, for example, right now, we are being connected over Teams, all right?
Right.
So we are using the service of the Teams, correct?
Yes.
But are we managing the Teams?
No.
Someone else has created up the Teams, someone else created up the meeting for us. Someone else is setting up the policies for those meetings, right?
Right.
So that comes over under manage. That means if I'm looking from the admin side.
Right.
So delegation is meant here itself for the RBAC. RBAC stands for role-based access control. Okay. RJ?
Yes.
So what are they going to manage? Which services they're going to manage? Let's say the services are hosted in Azure. Someone is creating up the website. Someone is managing the infrastructure. Someone is setting up the load balancer. Someone is setting up the storage. Someone is setting up the database. That means right. You have got a privilege to go and manage and configure and deploy the service on Azure. So what is that? That is something related to my admin. All right. Same way, let's say, for example, someone can manage my services which have been posted in Microsoft 365. Say, for instance, someone is a Teams administrator. Someone is a SharePoint administrator. Someone is the site owner. Someone is the Exchange administrator. Someone is a OneDrive admin. Someone is your SharePoint admin. Someone is your Yammer admin. So they are the admins.
Right.
Same way, let's say the services are hosted in Azure, in Microsoft 365, or let's say they are also maintaining and managing.
Hello.
The directory services as well, also where the identities are being kept and stored. So, but as an end user, we are going to consume the service. I just gave you an example of a Teams. Maybe let's say, for example, if you are using Outlook.
Right.
So Outlook is an application. We are going to consume that application, but someone else is going to set up the mailbox for us. Now, let's say, for example, I've got a SharePoint site. So as an end user, I'm going to consume that service. But someone is the SharePoint admin.
Right.
Someone is the SharePoint admin. All right. So the end user is going to consume that service. Now, where is this identity coming up from? This identity is all coming up from one of the directory service, which is being referred as identity as a service. And that identity as a service is none other than onto the cloud, which is Azure Active Directory, AAD. So onto the cloud itself, we have one directory service, which is Azure Active Directory. All right?
Right.
And this directory service comes up as the backbone for various Microsoft cloud services. Let's say if you're having the Microsoft 365 subscription, if you're having Azure subscription, if you're having, let's say MDM or Windows Intune subscription, with these subscriptions, you get a directory service, which is called Azure Active Directory, where my identities are residing, right?
Right.
Now, these identities, these identities can be, let's say, if I'm talking about the users, so a user can be a cloud user. A user can be a guest. A user can be a hybrid user. Hybrid in the sense it is coming from the on-prem.
Right.
On-prem, Windows, Active Directory, which is my ADDS. All right. Active Directory Domain Services, which is coming from the on-prem. So you can synchronize and you can set up the identity hybrid and you can synchronize those identities to the cloud and they're being referred as hybrid.
Well, identities. Here's the question. How would you go in between the two?
How do you?
Yes.
Can you please repeat your question?
How would you go in between, go from?
Okay. This identity hybrid. This identity hybrid is being set up by a tool, and that tool is being referred as Azure AD.
Okay.
Azure AD Connect.
Okay.
So this has to be set up. This has to be installed and configured on an on-prem, which will allow you to go and connect the Windows Active Directory and the Azure AD onto the cloud, and you can synchronize your required identities from the on-prem towards the cloud Azure AD. All right.
Right.
And there is one more identity category of the user, which is being referred as the guest. Guest is something, let's say, these are coming from the external directory. They are not a part of your directory. They are a part of some other external directory service, and they have been added in your Azure AD as a guest.
Yeah.
That means, let's say, for example, the authentication of these guests' account are happening in the external directory where their account exists. But in your directory service, you're authorizing them so that they can manage your service, they can consume your service. All right? Okay?
Okay.
Yes. So, in the case of hybrid, just a second. Oh, in the case of any identity, say here, say for example, I'm a guest. And this is me. All right? All right? And this guest account is in your Azure Active Directory. Okay, in your Azure Active Directory, I have been added as a guest, but this guest is having his own corporate credentials in our directory, in my directory. So let's say in my directory service. All right?
Mm-hmm.
And this account is Rajesh.
Right.
So this account, my credentials are here itself. My credentials are stored in my directory service, correct? When I say right. Credentials, I'm referring up to the username and password, all right?
Right.
So the credentials are not stored in your directory. That means this account, that is Rajesh, which has been added as a guest in your directory service, all right?
Mm-hmm.
And once it has been added in your directory service, what it has been considered as? It has been considered as what? Identity, right?
Right.
Now, why did you added me in your directory service? Probably, let's say, for example, you want to give me some delegation so that I can manage your service or I can consume a service. Correct?
Right.
So in most of the cases, these guest accounts are also added due to some business reason, which can be outsourced. All right. You understand outsourcing, correct?
Yes.
So when you outsource, so it can be for any given reason. At the moment, I just took an example of one account. You could have added so many other guests account from the same directory service or from a different directory service.
Right.
All right. At the moment, you just added this from one external directory service. Same way, you can have multiple different guests from different directory services, which can be added in your directory service. So this is organization A, and this is organization B. All right?
Yes.
So due to some business tie-up, due to some business agreements, you have invited the employees or the people or the users from my organization into yours as a guest. And then you're going to delegate them, then you're going to give them the access to the services, all right?
Right.
Yes, and this person has been sent an invite over email. Over email, all right?
Right.
So that email can be sent to an individual, or the email can be sent to a bulk of users as well also. So once the account has been added as a guest, then you're going to decide whether they need to manage your service, whether they want to consume your service. All right?
Okay.
So one is cloud. Cloud in the sense which resides in your directory service. Authentication, authorization happens from your directory service. Hybrid, which is coming from your on-prem corporate Windows Active Directory. Guest, which is coming from the external directory. All right? So these are all different types of users which you can have in your directory service. Correct? Okay?
Okay.
Good. So here itself, I just took an example of the enterprise apps, like say Teams, Outlook, SharePoint site, right? And let's say WebEx. So I might get connected to the WebEx. So that means I'm consuming that service. I'm not going to set up the WebEx. I'm not going to manage the WebEx. I'm going to consume that service. So end user. Okay. So similarly, if I talk about Microsoft 365, even for that one, you get the Azure AD. So this directory service comes up in different plans.
Okay.
And these plans are basically, let's say, for your different customers. Customers right. Can be your government organization, NGOs, or some medium-sized organizations, some enterprise-based organizations. Based on that, they have got different plans, and each and every plan is nothing but mine. A subscription. And these plans are providing you the different services. All right. So yes. any idea, Archie, that in your setup, which subscription are you guys using? Which plan are you using?
I think we're just using Office 365.
Correct. Office 365 is a subscription, I understand. But under that one, there are several different plans, let's say E1, E3, E5, and some other plans.
That I do not know.
Ah, okay. No worries.
I just know that. Hold on just for a second. I got to go use the bathroom. I'll be right back.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. So if you see, these are such different plans, let's say business basics, business standard, business premium. So if you look up, they are providing you various different services depending on your business needs. All right.
Yeah.
Bigger the organization, more the requirement, right?
Right.
And if you try to compare, each and every plan comes up with a license, and that license is assigned to the user.
Right.
The user, the one who is going to consume that service.
Yeah, I've had to work for a company where I had to set up that, where I had to give people licenses to use the Office 365 apps, Outlook and Word and all that stuff. So each license we bought, anytime we got down low where we had to get more licenses, then we bought them in bulk, you know, 10, 15, 20 at a time. So I do understand that.
Right. So these licenses are user-based, and depending on which particular plan you are having, accordingly, you can go assign that license. All right?
Yes.
So even into that one, it's possible that I can assign you the license, but I can also filter out some services for you. Filter out in the sense that there might be certain services which are not in use for you. So we can disable those services from that particular license.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Even though you are having the appropriate license, it might not be necessary that we will be able to consume all the services from that one. So that can be filtered up, but that again depends on the requirement, if required. All right. So this is something which initially has to be planned by any organization, by any customer, when they are getting onboarded to the cloud, depending on what plan, what services, what features are being provided, and how many licenses and which subscriptions do you require. Right. There is a huge planning which has to be done. But in your case, you have already onboarded up, so nothing much from the planning side. It's basically from the management side. Okay?
Right.
Yes. So this is the one. So now let's say for example, if I'm sitting on Microsoft 365, right? And this has got an admin portal. And from that admin portal, I can get connected to various other admin portals as well. All right, let's say I can reach out to admin centers.
Mm-hmm.
Admin centers, let's say basically for your Exchange, for your SharePoint, for your Teams, for your OneDrive, for your Yammer, for your compliance, so to reach out to these admin centers, what do we need? We need delegation. All right.
Right.
And this delegation is basically to manage the services. All right.
Right.
That means I'm looking from the admin side. Now, not everyone is a SharePoint admin. Not everyone is Exchange admin. I might be the admin, but not complete. Maybe, let's say, for example, in the SharePoint specifically, if I talk about, let's say someone is a SharePoint admin. All right. And let's say someone is the site admin. All right. Someone is a SharePoint admin, the one who can manage and create all the SharePoint sites. But on the other side, I can give someone as a site admin. That means he's the one who can manage the entire site, but not the complete SharePoint. Correct?
Right.
So the admin also has got different divisions. Admin also has got different segregations, right? Just saying that, okay, I'm the admin, doesn't mean that you're the entire admin for the SharePoint. So we have to be very specific that which particular admin have you been designated.
Right.
Maybe let's say, for example, in my Azure Active Directory, I can make someone as a global admin. I can make someone as a global admin.
Yeah, global admin will have access to everything.
Correct. But on the other side, if I give you the user admin, maybe let's say, for example, you're not the global admin, you're just a user admin. That means you can create up the users, you can set up the passwords. That's it. But are you the entire global admin for the Azure AD? Not at all.
No.
You are an admin, but that defines the scope. And the scope is nothing but the boundary.
Right.
So the scope is very important, that what is your scope of work? All right?
Right. I got you. Got you.
Right. So sometimes it might be a situation that as per the business need, as per the project need, you might have been given a delegation for the site admin, not for the SharePoint admin.
Right.
So it's not always the admin. It's many cases, it's also the end user. You being as a site admin, what you did, you created up the libraries. You created up the lists. You configured the permissions. Permissions for whom? Permissions for the end users. All right?
Right.
You set it up the library, documents, contents. You set it up the permissions for the end users. And the end users are going to consume that service. All right?
Right.
So you configure up a, let's say, site A. So you're the admin of this, but they are the end user for this. All right?
Yeah, so can you just set up an admin for just one specific folder?
That's not how exactly it works. See, it's okay. That's a very uncommon situation that someone is made a member and someone is made the admin of one particular folder only. That's very, very unusual. Right?
All right.
Probably, see, if I talk about from the end user, I can think about that one. Why? Because maybe as an end user, I've got multiple libraries. Say, for example, I've got a library for videos. I've got a library for, slides. So as an end user, I can give you the permission to that user so that they can only access the slides.
Okay.
Right into that library. But I can also give you the permission in such a manner that you can manage that library. Manage in the sense you can upload, you can download, you can set up the permission for that library. I can give you that level of an access. So that's also somehow very close to the admin of that library. All right. Okay. Archie.
Yeah, Archie. I'm here. Yeah, I'm muted. So if my dog starts barking.
It's okay, no worries. Case if it disturbs, I'll ask you. But so there is nothing like a library admin. It's just a matter of the permissions what you give to that end user. If I just give you the read access, that means you can consume. But on the other side, if I give you the write permission and modify and delete permission, that means you can manage that library as well also.
Right.
So it's just a matter of what the permissions. All right. It's just a matter of the permissions. Correct?
Yes, correct.
Get it. So although if it had been the SharePoint on-prem, then you might have seen there is a huge architecture which has to be managed by different teams. But when you go down to the cloud, most of the management is quite well reduced. But yes, still the management is there, administration is there itself, but not as compared to the what you have to do on an on-prem. Okay.
Okay.
So